Chris. A-hole Productions.
We know each other so well, don't we, Lance?
Well, we've always been each other's greatest nemesis. This is Psy. Nemesis. What's the plural on that?
Nemesis.
Whatever.
Hey, what's up, everyone? Welcome back to another episode of Nemeseek. I know it's been a while since I made any Resident Evil content, but, you know, I wanted to take a little break after that last trailer because I thought it was so cool, and I wanted to kind of go online and watch other people's reactions, watch other people's theories videos. The one thing I stayed away from was leaks. There's a lot of people out there leaking a ton of stuff. Capcom's definitely got to put a cork in that leak for sure, because there's someone out there apparently that is just pumping the internet full of potential leaks, because I guess they did some, you know, playing of this game. Like, it's what sucks is before I left California that I got an invite that it was like, all right, you got to take the survey and, you know, tell us why you think you'd be a good choice for, you know, testing Resident Evil 8, or I think it was Resident Evil 8. I don't know. They just said a Resident Evil game. So for all I know, it was Resistance, because this was a while ago. So I was, you know, I applied and I was hoping I would get in, and I didn't. And I was like, dang, you know, it sucks, because I was hoping to do that as one of my last things in California before I moved here to Florida. But whoever did play it, I guess maybe it was Resident Evil 8, and there's been leaks all over the place, which is so stupid. It's like one of those things where, you know, if you get an opportunity like that, bite your tongue, you know? Like, don't ruin it for other people, because once you start leaking stuff, it gets companies to not want to do this anymore, you know? And the downside is they need feedback from people, whether they're making movies, TV, or video games. Like, they need some people to get early access, you know, people who are hardcore fans, you know, regular, you know, kind of on the surface fans who just kind of know what Resident Evil is. Like, they need viewpoints from all over. And if you, you know, leak stuff out there, you ruin further opportunities for other people to, you know, get a chance to have these once-in-a-lifetime experiences, you know? So that's, you know, please, like, stop leaking stuff. It's ridiculous. I hate, you know, that. And that's why I try not to cover any leaks on these shows, on all the shows I do, whether here, Venom Vlog. You know, I don't want to talk about leaks. So I stayed away from leaks because there are people out there that apparently have story points and all this other stuff. I have my own theories and I like having my own guesses, but it was really fun. And I'm still, to this day, every once in a while, I'll just go on YouTube and go Resident Evil 8 trailer reactions, and I just watch people's reactions and kind of see how pumped up they get for this game, and what, you know, what, how they reacted to the werewolves, the inclusion of werewolves, and all these other stuff. And I like it. I like seeing people react to that. It's like I watch people react to music online, hearing music for the first time, and I'm such a fan of music. So when I see people reacting to like Queen for the first time or the Beatles or something, it's awesome. You know, it's really cool. So I get into that. So after watching for like 2 months now, I think it's been like two or three months since we got that Resident Evil 8 trailer. Now I was like, you know what? Let's talk about the one time where werewolves actually did appear in Resident Evil. So that was one thing when I first heard the rumors online. I think someone left a comment like, oh, Resident Evil 8 might have werewolves. And I was like, eh, and I never paid attention to it. And then I think Where's Barry said something like that in one of his streams. And I was like, eh, I doubt that's ever going to happen. And then it did happen, and I was like, wow, I can't believe this trailer with all those little rumors about werewolves and stuff was actually true. And then it got me thinking, well, you know, I have all the Resident Evil magazines, the original Wildstorm ones, and a lot of the comic books in, you know, trade paperback forms like Fire and Ice and stuff like that. And I said, you know, wasn't there werewolves in one of those issues? And I was right. Actually, this cover here, let me tilt the camera back, by Jim Lee, actually, drew Claire Redfield. Jim Lee did the cover of issue 1 and issue 3 there. But the story itself inside issue 3 is by Ted Adams is the writer, and Ryan Odagawa is the artist. And it's this little story, and I'll have some of the artwork popping up here too. It's this little story that takes place right before Resident Evil 1, and it involves a werewolf, which is crazy, because I remember when this story came out, you know, for fans, hardcore fans, because that was like the early days of me talking to people on the internet about stuff, and this was after Resident Evil 2 came out, around the time I think Resident Evil 3 was coming out, when these magazines started coming out, and or maybe between 3 and Code Veronica, somewhere in there. And so I would talk to people online, and it was pretty universal. Nobody liked this story. Everyone was like, werewolves, that's so dumb. Why would Umbrella make werewolves, or how could they create a werewolf, or is this an Umbrella thing? Is this just a random werewolf guy? Because they never really talk about the connections in this story to Umbrella. But all we get is that it takes place before Resident Evil 1, and obviously this is not video game canon, obviously. Although most of the stories in these magazines were actually discussed with Capcom. So Wildstorm, when they got the rights, like Jim Lee, this was his company, he was like, we want the rights to Res Evil to make magazines and release comic books. So that's what they did, and they worked with, you know, staff members at Capcom to come up with some stories, or at least bounce ideas off them. So you could argue that, you know, maybe these are like a drifting continuity, but they're not true game continuity. So, you know, for sure, like definitely not. But it's still interesting because that story was pretty reviled. Most people were like, you know, what's the deal with this? You start off with these three kids. It's like Mike and this girl, Michelle, and one of their friends. And they're walking around college campus at, you know, at Raccoon City College. And which I'm guessing is more of like a community college, maybe. I don't know. I think there was, I don't know if there was a university, because I know in, what was it, Outbreak chapters 1 and 2, they had like other, you know, places you could go to in Raccoon City. I don't know if there was a proper university in Raccoon City. I can't remember that. So it might have just been like a small community college or something. But either way, these three students are talking about how one of their, you know, fellow classmates died and that her body was found torn up. So of course you're like, well, it's before Res Evil 1. It's probably a zombie got her, you know, because at that time there was like the jogger that was out in the woods that they found, you know, the police found their body and stuff. So it seems like that. So you're like, okay, it's, you know, clearly a zombie got her or something. And you know, that's the story. That's Resident Evil. That's the world of Resident Evil. But then as you see, it cuts to one of the girls, Michelle, I think. She's like the nerdy Velma type. She gets killed and the silhouette looks like something that's not a zombie. It looks more like a werewolf. Then we cut to Wesker, you know, who's head of STARS, obviously, and he's in on the Umbrella stuff, as we find out in the video games. So Umbrella, you know, or Wesker being kind of the main bad guy, I guess, in some ways of the first game, and then later on when he comes back in the other games, he does kind of send Jill and Barry on this mission. So it looks like, you know, STARS have been forming. They're in Raccoon City. You know, the RPD are having trouble with these various murders that are happening. And this one in particular, like, hey, can you send a STARS team in and maybe someone in undercover to be a student? Because it looks like someone is stalking students on the college campus. And so Jill was like, okay, I'll volunteer. Because Jill's young. I think she's like 23 or 22 or something when she's part of STARS. So she's young. So they're like, hey, why don't we send Jill in as a student and Barry, you be her point of contact. And this will be a side mission for you two to go on and get to the bottom of this. And you don't really see Wesker's point of view in this. He sends him on this mission, but you don't see him wondering, like, what is this? Is this a, you know, could this be a hunter gotten out of its pen? You know, like, he does, you don't really get his perspective. And I wish they added some of that, because I think that would have been cool to have Wesker confused of what's happening. Because I don't think, I mean, I guess a lab in Raccoon City somewhere, because there's, now that we've done remakes and all these other things, I guess there's been three or four different labs in Raccoon City working on stuff. So maybe one of them somehow created a werewolf, but we don't know for sure. Or maybe just werewolves exist in the world of Resident Evil, you know, so, and that's, I don't know, maybe that's possible too. So anyway, so we have this story where Jill goes in undercover and she gets attacked by a wolf. She loses communication with Barry and then she falls to the ground, pulls out her gun. She's like, freeze, don't move. And this thing jumps out at her and you see it finally in the spotlight and it's a wolf and she shoots it and kills it. And then the story ends with her and Barry talking and Barry's like, hey, I could hear you on the intercom, but I guess you couldn't hear me. So I came in to help and I heard your gunfire. So I came over here. And I thought on the walkie you said it was a wolf that you killed. And she goes, yeah, it was. Look. And they look over and it's just a naked guy who gets shot. And she's like, oh, wow, it's dark out here. Maybe I was confused. I don't know. And he's like, yeah. He goes, let's just say that and let's call the police and get them in here to, like, help us with the investigation. And she goes, yeah, I guess so. And she goes, but he did attack me, so, you know, I had to put him down. And Barry's like, don't worry, you know, that's it seems like we might have got our guy or whatever. So it's a really brief story. You don't really get any major conclusion other than the wolf guy dies and he turns back into a human. So I don't know. Like, it's just one of those things where after I saw the trailer, it sat with me for like a couple days and I was like, you know, I feel like werewolves did pop up in the comics and I just wanted to go back and reread them. So I did, you know, had all these, hadn't framed them yet. So I read them all. And then I was like, all right, now that I read them all and I got some, you know, images for you guys to show, I was like, now I can frame them and they can be in the background in this episode. So yeah, you know, let me know what you think. You know, the addition of werewolves into Resident Evil in the video game universe now is intriguing because I'm wondering if it's virus related or if it's some kind of genetic, you know, creation of some kind. I'm kind of curious where they're going to go in Resident Evil 8 with the science part of it, you know, because obviously it looks very supernatural-ish. Like, they're like, oh, it's a village and there might be these witch ladies or a vampire or something. Like, you know, it looks like there's all these elements of like old school monsters, But I feel like it's Resident Evil. It kind of has to fall back into science in some way, because most of the monsters in the universe are created by science. So obviously, I doubt there's going to be any connections or reference in Resident Evil 8 video game to this comic book story. But I still wanted to talk about it because I was just like, well, it's fun, you know. And I you know, there's not a lot of people out there who make YouTube content that are hardcore Resident Evil fans that do cover these magazines. I know there's a couple out there that have, but not a ton. So I thought, you know what, why not talk about it on this episode and bring it to you guys in, you know, one of my shows. So there you go. You know, this little story, this short story about a werewolf that most people didn't even like when it came out and were rolling their eyes and like, come on, man, there's already zombies, there's hunters, there's all these other cool monsters. Why bring in werewolves? And then now we got werewolves in Resident Evil 8. So I guess we can all just put our foot in our mouths at that point. But I'm excited though. The new trailer looked great for Resident Evil 8. I'm very excited for it. I'm like intrigued by the idea of werewolves and other creatures, you know. It looks like there was a giant in the trailer, there was like a giant guy with a hammer coming down, like dropping down. That reminded me of some of the executioners and monsters from other Resident Evil games. So yeah, I can't wait to see how this all comes together. Hopefully we'll get some more Resident Evil 8 news soon. And we did get some other news though. Just yesterday we got the announcement officially from Netflix that there's going to be a Resident Evil TV show. So I'm going to make that in our next episode of Nemeseek, which I'm going to record right after this. We're going to go over to Hollywood Reporter. The Hollywood Reporter did a Leslie Goldberg, someone who I used to know, and I used to, you know, wrote a couple stories for them and for her and you know, Hollywood Reporter back when Arrow came out and, you know, those shows and Flash and stuff. So I'm, you know, anxious to read her article, see what she says about the announcement that Netflix made on you know, Twitter. And Andrew Dobb, who's the co-creator of or co-executive producer of the recent Supernatural series, which is one of my favorite shows. I love Supernatural. And I like some of the work they've been doing over the past few seasons. I know there are a lot of hardcore Supernatural fans only love the first five seasons. I love the first five seasons too, but I do like a lot of stuff they've done post season five as well. So we'll talk more about that in the next episode. So next episode is all going to be about the Resident Evil TV show, the plot to it, and some of that, you know, information that came out. We'll talk about that next. But for here, let me know what you think about this werewolf story. You know, I thought it was silly when it first came out, and now you just can't help but go, well, did the creators of Resident Evil 8 maybe read that story at some point? Or did someone who worked on Resident Evil 8, who maybe worked at Capcom back then, you know, knew about that story existing in Wildstorm and was like, oh, that's a good idea to put in the back of my head one day. And maybe that person now is making ideas over at, you know, Capcom and said, hey, let's do werewolves next. I don't know, whatever it is, I'm intrigued. So we'll talk about it more down in the comments below. Let me know your thoughts so we can continue down there. Thanks so much for watching the show. As always, like, share, subscribe, all that fun stuff. And I'll see you in the future. Peace.